Bible says on the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, "If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water." But this is spoke concerning the Spirit, whom those believing in him would receive. For the Holy Spirit was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. Now the story is in the last day of the Feast of Tabernacles. It is 6 months before Jesus is betrayed, tortured, and slaughtered. Normally, for me and most of us, the tendency, knowing that in 6 months to come, you will be betrayed and tortured and slaughtered, the tendency would be to withdraw and hold up in isolation. But instead of Jesus holding up in isolation, he steps out and joins the rest of the Jews for this important convocation, instead of withdrawing. Then it's in that last day, there are 3 major feasts in Israel: the Feast of Passover, the Feast of Pentecost, and the Feast of Tabernacles. This was the happiest feast. And during that Feast of Tabernacles, which was commemorated 8 days, 7 days, and then 8th day, being the last day, the Bible says, where we read, on the last day of the feast, the 8th day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, "If any man thirst, let him come to me, and those who believe in me, out of their belly shall flow rivers of living waters." And this is spoke concerning the Holy Spirit, who was to be given, because the Holy Spirit had not been given, because Jesus had not been glorified. He begins by saying, "If any man thirst, let him come." The Bible is a book full of invitations. The Bible is a book of invitations. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18 and 19. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18 and 19. The Bible says, "Come unto me, come now, and let us reason together. Though your sins be like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be like crimson, they shall be as wool. If you be willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land." The Bible is full of invitation. Here the Lord is saying, "Come, let's reason together." In Isaiah 55 and verse 1, Isaiah 55 verse 1, "Everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And you have no money, come, buy and eat. Yes, come, buy wine and milk without money and without price." God is saying that without money, come, you shall buy and you are going to eat. Matthew 11 verse 28 to 30, Matthew 11 verse 28 to 30, "Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I shall give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest to your soul. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Jesus stood and saying, "If anybody thirsts, let him come." Revelation 22 and verse 17. Revelation 22 verse 17. "The Spirit and the bride say, come. And let anyone who desires, let him come and drink freely the waters of life." It's a book. It's a book. The Bible is a book that is full of, it's a book that is full of invitations. And the Lord today, the Spirit and the bride is saying to every one of us, "Come, you who is heavy laden, you who is sinful, come, let's reason together. You who is thirsty, come, buy and eat. the Feast of the Tabernacles, Jesus stands and he says, if any man thirst, let him come. Now, during the Feast of Tabernacles, the whole country or the Israelites would go to the wilderness and stay for 8 days in the tent of booths. And the parents would narrate to their children the miracles that God did in the wilderness for 40 years. How God led them with a cloud at night, during the day, and a pillar of fire at night. How God provided water from the rock. How day by day, God provided bread, manna, in the wilderness. But also during this Feast of Tabernacles, it both commemorated the past, but also it was indicating, it was also telling about the future. It was not just commemorating the past, but also anticipating the future. And in those 8 days, for 7 days, there was a procession of these Jews who would go to the pool of Siloam, collect water as an indication of how God miraculously provided water in the wilderness, the 40 years that they were in the wilderness. So they would come with pitchers, pick water from Siloam, and then come pour them in the temple every single day for 7 days. But on the 8th day, they would go to this place called Siloam. The meaning of Siloam is sent one. The meaning of Siloam is sent one. On the 8th day, they would go to that pool of Siloam, but then they would come back without water, which was a proclamation, an indication that we are no longer in the wilderness. We were in the wilderness for 7 is a number of completion, of perfection. They were in the wilderness for 40 days, which is also a number of completion, number of testing. So they were in the wilderness for 40 years, but after those 40 years, finally they were ushered into the land of Canaan, where they did need the miraculous water from the rock. Because now in the land of Canaan, there is water by rain. They did, you know, they are no longer in the wilderness. But now, so that is why on the 8th day, they would come with empty vessels to indicate we are no longer in the wilderness. Now we are in the land of Canaan. Where we are in the land of Canaan, there is perpetual provision of water. But then, even at that time when they are there, because this was not just a commemoration of the past, it was also an anticipation of the future, when on the 8th day, they would come with empty vessels, and then the high priest would read Isaiah 44 and verse 3. The high priest would read Isaiah 44 and verse 3, that God shall provide. Isaiah 44, for I will pour water to the thirsty, the flood to the dry ground. I will pour my spirit to your descendants and my blessing to your offspring. Now the high priest, every single year, every year, on the 8th day, that was a prayer for the Messiah, because it was a prayer. Although we have come to the land of Canaan and we no longer need the physical water, we have the available physical water, but spiritually we are still thirsty. So they would read that verse and make a prayer. Oh God, send the Messiah who will come to pour water to the thirsty, who will come to pour flood to the dry ground, who will come to pour the spirit to the descendant. But the Messiah comes, he shall pour the blessings to the offspring. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So they will make that prayer, the prayer of send the Messiah, because they are coming from Siloam. Siloam means sent one, and then Messiah means the sent one. The Messiah means the sent one. When he comes, he shall provide the living water. He shall provide the water. He shall refresh us with the waters, and with that water that he shall provide to us, it shall not just be a water for us. It shall be a river, a living water that is going to refresh and serve many more people. Amen. Hallelujah. On the last day, that great day of the feast, this carpenter from Galilee, when people are whispering, send the Messiah, send the Messiah who shall bring the living water, the river of water. Then on that last day, this carpenter from Galilee stood up and cried out, saying, if any man thirst, let him come to me, and he who believes in me, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. This was speaking about, was speaking concerning the Holy Spirit. Now, if you are born again, we have the Holy Spirit in us. The question is not about having the Holy Spirit in you. The question is that the Holy Spirit have Many believers possess the Spirit, but they have not been possessed by the Spirit. It makes all the difference, because the moment you just have Him, then it means you are in control. It means you can boast Him around. It means you can push Him. You control when to let Him out and when to lock Him in. But today I'm talking not just of the Spirit in you. I'm talking of a river, the living water that flows from you to refresh and serve other people. The river, the living water that wherever they go, they bring healing and they bring salvation and they bring restoration and a change in those who are dead and those who are dry. Praise the Lord. It's living waters when the Spirit of God is totally in control. When there is an overflow, He's not just in you, He has come upon you to empower you for ministry and for service. Ezekiel saw a vision in Ezekiel chapter 47. Ezekiel chapter 47, the Bible says that an angel of God took Ezekiel where there was the temple. And on the right side of that temple, there was water, there was a river that was flowing from the gate on the right side. And verse 3 to 6, Ezekiel 47, verse 3 to 6, the Bible says that this angel took Ezekiel 1,000 cubits, and the waters were at the ankles. And then he took him another 1,000 cubits, and the waters were on the knees. And he was taking another 1,000 cubits, and the waters were at the waist. And then he was taking another 1,000 cubits, and this time he could not stand. He was now overhead with the river. He was now overflowing, controlled by the river. What does it mean? This is a picture of the life in the Spirit. Every child of God, we have a life in the Spirit, but there are steps of your life in the Spirit. It all begins where the water, which is a symbol, a type, a picture, an emblem of the Spirit of God, it begins by the waters being at the ankles, which means I'm standing on the promises of God. But it is not enough for you to stand on the promises of God. And then He pushes you forward. He pushes you deeper. And now you discover that there are some situations in your life that need you to wrestle in prayer. And you begin to pray. When you begin to wrestle and pray, the waters are on your knees. But as you continue to discover, you have your relatives that need Jesus. You have your neighbors, your colleagues that need to be introduced to this Jesus. You begin to witness and to minister to them. As you're ministering and witnessing to them, there is a reproduction. Now the waters are on your waist. It is a place of reproduction. It is not enough for you to be a witness and a minister. You need to go deeper in your relationship with the Spirit of God. As you go deeper, it is no longer on the ankles or on the knees or as reproduction. It is a river. You cannot control it any further. Now you are being carried and controlled by the Spirit of God. It's a river. Hallelujah. The living waters, they are taking charge. They are taking control of your conversation. They are taking control of your thoughts. They are taking control of all your relationships. The river has taken over. It is the living waters now. Amen. Praise the Lord. Now, what does it mean practically for you to move from the waters at the ankles to the knees, to the waist, a place of reproduction, to a place where the river is carrying you, is possessing you, no longer you possessing the Spirit, but the Spirit has possessed your money, the Spirit has possessed your ministry, the Spirit has possessed your business, that means the Spirit of God is in charge of your friends and everything that is about you. There are three steps for consideration when it comes to moving in these steps I'm talking about in the Spirit. Number one, very quickly, come to the rock. Number one, come to the rock. Come to the rock. That is where it starts. In your moving, in your relationship with the living waters. Number one, it all starts as come to the rock. Exodus chapter 17 and verse 6. Exodus 17 verse 6. The children of Israel had come to a place called Rephidim. They had just crossed from Egypt. They had just crossed the Red Sea. And then now in the wilderness, and at this place called Refidima, they cried out to Moses. They contended with Moses. Why did you bring us to this wilderness to die? Would you rather have stayed in Egypt? Because there was water in Egypt and they were thirsty in the wilderness. But the journey had started. And God said to Moses, behold, I will stand before you there on the rock in Horeb, and you shall strike the rock, and water will come out of it. God says to Moses, even as these people are complaining and murmuring against Moses, the Lord said to Moses, you bring them at the rock, and when you get at the rock, smite the rock, and the rock is going to provide you with the waters. Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 4, they all drank on the same drink, and they drank from that spiritual rock that followed them. And that rock is Christ, the rock that was providing water in the wilderness. Paul says that rock is Christ. And at the beginning, at the onset of the journey of the Israelites, the journey of faith, it all started with the smiting of the rock. The Bible says in John 19 and verse 34, John 19 verse 34, as Jesus was hanging on the cross, there came a centurion with a spear. He thrust on his side, and the Bible says from his side came water and blood. And the Bible says in 1 John chapter 5 and verse 6, 1 John chapter 5 verse 6, he didn't just come with water alone, but he came with water.
Because Jesus is not to be smiled.
meted twice. He was meted once and for all. 2,000 years ago at Calvary. Any other time you are fasting your journey, after Jesus has been meted at the beginning of the, at the onset of the journey, wherever else you are hanging, any other time you are fasting, any other time you are sick, you don't need to smite him. You just speak to the Lord. But the Bible says that Moses and his brother Aaron, instead of speaking to the rock as God had instructed, they decided they are tired by the whining of his congregation. And the Bible says they struck the rock not once but twice. But because they disobeyed God and they misrepresented God, they failed to hallow him. The Bible says in Numbers 20 verse 12, God called them aside and the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron, because you did not believe me to hallow me, you did not believe me to sanctify me before these people. You thought I am mad with them. Why did you insult them when you called them rebels? Why did you misrepresent me? You showed these people that I'm angry with them, yet my mercies are new every morning. The Bible says Psalm 103, verse 13 and 14, Psalm 103, 13 and 14, as a father pities their children, so the Lord pities those who fear him, because God knows our frame. He remembers we are not angels. He remembers we are not perfect. He remembers we are not altogether lovely. There is only one who is altogether lovely, and he was meeted. It is the Lord that was meeted at Calvary. So anytime I'm not doing well, oh, the Lord is inviting me morning by morning, evening by evening, that if only I can speak to the Lord, I'm going to be refreshed. I'm going to be blessed again. It doesn't matter how the things I've had. I just need to speak to the Lord. He's going to refresh me. And he's going to bless me. He's the Rock of Ages that was meeting at Calvary. The Lord is speaking to you today categorically. Just speak to the Lord. Just talk to him about that situation. Oh, hallelujah. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. We don't need to carry these burdens anymore. We are sheep, we are not donkeys. We are not designed to carry burdens. The Lord says to you and me today, cast all your cares upon me, for I care for you. Bible says in Luke 11 verse 13, if you've been evil, you know how to give good gifts to your children. How much more shall our Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit, the living waters, to those who ask? You just ask in prayer. Matthew 7 verse 7 and 8, ask and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. Knock and the door shall be opened unto you. For whoever asks receives. Whoever seeks finds. Whoever knocks, the door is open unto him. Jeremiah 33 verse 3, call unto me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things which you do not know. 1 John chapter 5 verse 14 and 15. 1 John chapter 5 verse 14 and 15. The Bible says that we know that the petition, now this is the confidence we have in him, that if we ask anything, tell your neighbor anything. That if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know he hears us, then we know we have whatever we have asked, all the petitions that we have asked of him. And that is the confidence that Jesus was meeting at Calvary. That today I don't need to strike him by my jumping physically or by my lashing out in frustration. I don't need to be frustrated emotionally. I just need to appear before the Rock of Ages and tell him, Lord, my master, I need an open door. I need favor. Have mercy on me. Forgive me, Lord. Restore me, revive me. When I speak to him, he's faithful and just. Hallelujah. To forgive us and to bless us. Finally, number three, sing to the Lord. Come to the Lord. Speak to the Lord. Number three, sing to the Lord. Numbers 21 and verse 16 to 18. Numbers 21, verse 16 to 18. Remember, they had a journey of 40 years in the wilderness. It all started with the smiting of the rock. It upgraded to speaking to the rock. And when the rock was beaten, it provided water. When it speak to the rock, it provided the living water, the water. But now finally, The Lord said to Moses, at a place called Pia, which is the way where the Lord said to Moses, gather the people together, and I will give them water. This time there was no even complaint. It's not even the congregation who murmured for water, but God, out of his own will, he said to Moses, gather the people together, and I'm going to give them water. I'm going to refresh them. And he said, this is how I shall provide the water. Then Israel sang this song. Spring up, O well, all of you sing to Egypt. The well the leader sank, dug by the nation's nobles, by the Lord giver with your states. And from the wilderness they went to Matana. The Lord is saying, yes, the rock was smitten, provided the water. You have spoken to the rock, you have prayed about your situation. Now God is saying, the water shall be provided by you singing. The theologians, many theologians say that it is not a physical, literal rock that was following the Israelites in the wilderness. They said there was a subterranean, there was a river from where the rock was. There was a stream, a river that was flowing underground in the journey of the Israelites. So where they were standing, although there was no water, although it was dry, where they were standing, underneath the surface was a river, was a refreshing living water. But you can't see it because it is underground. But God said, gather the people together, and when you bring them together, let them sing in faith, let them shout in faith, let them dance in faith. Although they have not seen the miracle, as they sing to the Lord, he shall provide the waters.
Hallelujah.
You do it by faith. You can't see the miracle, but it is there by faith. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 1 verse 3, Ephesians chapter 1 verse 3, the Bible says, blessed be God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings. Tell your neighbor, I'm blessed. Tell your neighbor, I'm blessed. God has blessed us. I don't look like I am blessed, but I'm blessed. I don't walk like I'm blessed, but I'm blessed. The Bible says in 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 2 and verse 3, grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and our Lord Jesus Christ, as his divine power has given to us all, thank you, neighbor, all. He has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. What you need for spiritual is provided. What you need for the physical is provided. You may not see it, but it is there. They couldn't see the water, but there was underneath a stream of living waters from the rock. Jesus, the rock of ages, he has provided the answers, the solution to your problems. And now he's saying to you and me today, sing it out in faith. Don't agree with what the devil is trying to show you. Rise up and sing a psalm. Sing it out in faith. Because as you sing, the rock provides the refreshment. He provides the miracles. The well is exposed as you sing in faith. Ephesians chapter 5 verse 18 and 19. Ephesians 5, 18 and 19. The Bible says that. Ephesians 5 verse 18 and 19. And do not be drunk with wine, in which is dissipation or debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves with psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, and making melody in your hearts, and to the Lord. Glory to God. How do you get this Spirit filled? We come together. That's why we come together in church. We come together in church because when we come together in church, like I said, step one, we come to the rock that was smitten. When we are sharing the broken bread and the cup in Holy Communion, we are reminded we are coming to the rock that was smitten at Calvary. But also we come together in church, because when we come together in church, we speak to God in prayer. We speak to God about our situations in prayer. We are speaking to the rock. And as we speak to the Lord in prayer, he hears and he answers. And not just speaking, not just coming to the smitten rock, but also we speak to the rock in prayer. When we are in church, but also when we are in church, we begin to sing praise, we begin to worship. And when we are doing that, we are singing to the rock. And as long as we are coming to the rock, and we are speaking to the rock, and we are singing to the rock, there's going to be a refreshing. The Spirit of God is going to overflow and bless our lives and restore us. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. Thank you, Jesus. You're the rock that was beaten at Calvary. And you provided salvation. You provided redemption for us. You provided justification and sanctification. Lord, you're the available rock that when you call upon you, you shall answer. You say, whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall never be put to shame. Whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And now, God, we are calling on you in our situations, even as we sing to you praise and worship and adoration, because you're our very present help. You're our refuge and our shield. You're our very present help in time of trouble. I pray for every listener right now that, God, may they experience these living waters. May there be an overflowing of the river of God. May the river of God, the river of life, the river of healing, the river of restoration and deliverance, the river of breakthrough and miracles, may this river flow in us and even through us in Jesus' mighty name. May there be a refreshment in every one of us. May there be a lifting and promotion and a restoration. We thank you, Jesus. We worship and we magnify you. For in Jesus' name, we pray and give thanks. Amen. The Lord